Okay, good afternoon, friends. And after the very exciting inaugural sessions address by Mr. Palak Shah, we are again going to have another session, and that is by one of the very eminent chartered accountant as well as a visiting faculty to our institute, Professor C.A. Rupesh Shah. Professor Rupesh Shah sir is a qualified chartered accountant, and he is also a strategic finance leader with more than 2.5 decades of experience providing financial leadership and guidance in complete gamut of finance, tax and accounts function, including corporate finance, taxation, mergers and acquisition, project finance, fundraising and investment management in real estate. He was heading the finance and accounts function for real estate development and also investment in stock market business of the Pratham Group. As a passion to contribute towards the society, he has also conducted various training programs from Indian Accounting Standard, Understanding Balance Sheet, Finance for Non-Finance Executives, GST and its impact, lending decision, training, etc. C.A. Rupesh Shah sir has also conducted training for Kotak Mahindra Bank, Axis Bank, Yes Bank, IDFC Bank and various top management institute. He is also the committee member on the SME Rehabilitation Committee of Bank of Baroda, Mumbai, and he is also a member Board of Advisory on various startups, ventures in Mumbai as well as Ahmedabad. He is in the field of investment advisory and value investor for more than decades. He has co-authored industry-specific publication for ICAI. He is also contributing, as I mentioned, as a visiting faculty at many of the, you know, reputed B schools in Mumbai, and serves as advisory board of studies in many of these B-schools. He has trained many students in the area of equity finance as well as banking. Sir, it is a very great pleasure to have you with us, and I request you to share your thoughts about fundamental analysis and how it is important for the young audience. Over to you, sir.
So thank you very much, Anita ji, and it is indeed my proud privilege to be part of, you know, this particular event and share my thoughts on the topic of fundamental analysis. So with this, you know, I will start sharing my presentation. In the moment it is visible on your screen, just, you know, let me know the once it is, you know, visible on your screen. Is it visible?
Yes, sir.
Okay, great. So, you know, the topic, you know, for today, you know, the flow of the topic will be, we will discuss about few important things, you know, which is very necessary in the area of the fundamental analysis. And then after that, we will take up, right? We will take up the, you know, question and answer on this. So as, you know, the topic suggests, the fundamental analysis. Now, what we mean by the, you know, meaning of the fundamental analysis? Now, as I understand, there are a lot of students from many B schools are participating in this event. You know, for this young rising star, you know, I would just like to tell you that there are essentially two approaches for investments or approaching the stock market. The first is fundamental analysis and another is a technical analysis. And third and very emerging area is called a techno-fundamental analysis. So very logical question comes, what is the meaning of this fundamental analysis and what is the meaning of, you know, technical analysis? So fundamental analysis basically deals with the, you know, finding out the worth of the company, the value of the company, intrinsic value of the company, and buying the any stock which is less than this intrinsic value, and in the process holding this company in the long run and ride the wealth creation journey. That is actually, the meaning and the purpose of the fundamental analysis. However, the technical analysis, as name suggests, which deals with the difference in the price. Now, in stock market, we have various participants. We have an investor, we have a trader, we have a speculator, we have an arbitrager. Now, the traders and the speculators are very much interested in looking at, you know, past historical performance of the prices, and they plot this in the form of the chart. There are various charts like candlestick chart, line chart, bar chart, etc. And they try to understand the psychology of the market participants by interpreting these price behavior, increase and decrease in the price along with the volume. So technical analysis basically deals with the understanding the movement in the price, understanding the trend, and to capture the difference between the two price, between two time frame, and make the profit out of it. It may be by going long, or it may be by going short, right? But the trader eventually has no intention to hold these stocks for the long term. That is all about technical analysis. Third approach is techno fundamental analysis, which is a very, very recent approach. And there are many professionals in the market who combine both technical and the fundamental and try to make the profits out of it. But that is some other day we will discuss techno fundamental. It is a very emerging subject. Now let us go deep into the fundamental analysis. Now, as you can see on this chart, on this slide, right, the fundamental analysis is the building block. The fundamental analysis is the most important part is in the fundamental analysis is actually to have the business owner mindset. Now that is the base, that is the whole crux of the fundamental analysis. Whenever any investor try to buy the stock of a company, he has a owner's mindset. He doesn't have a mindset of the employee or a mindset of the trader or a mindset of a speculator. He will try to buy the stock and think that he is a minority shareholder and the part owner of the company. Any particular stock he doesn't buy as if it is a piece of a paper, but he buy as if he is a part owner of the company, and that is called the owner's mindset. And he will try to keep these stocks as longer the period as he can, provided the fundamentals of the companies are intact and the valuations are in his favor, right? So that is called an owner's mindset. That is a business owner's mindset. So there are various pillars in the fundamental analysis. And the very first pillar is, you know, looking for an outstanding company. That means, you know, when an investor approach and study any particular sector or any particular company, he will try to find out a fantastic business. He will try to find out a superior businesses. Now there are two approach here, top down approach and bottom up approach. Under top down approach, investor first look at lot of macro events, lot of macro analysis about industry, sector and the economy, and boils down to the, you know, exciting or some of the promising sector, and within that sector he will try to find out some fantastic or extraordinary company in order to invest. That is called a top down approach. Under bottom up approach, the investor does exactly the reverse. He will look at individual company on a zero based basis and try to find out whether these businesses are extraordinary or not. And if he finds so, then he will move to the valuations and try to see whether the valuations are in his favor or not. And if answer is yes, then he will buy those company. That is called a bottom up approach. So here the word outstanding company or outstanding business is very important. Now why it is so? Because the in the investment field, you know, the Warren Buffett and Charlie Munger has put this very, very nicely, that, you know, whenever you look at two things in the investments, one is the extraordinary company or an outstanding company and a very good management. Now between the two, you have to give a more weightage to the extraordinary company or an outstanding company. Because even if the company is not good, but promoter is good, but company is not good, business is not good, then eventually the investor will not make money. So the very first condition is to not to compromise on quality of the business. A business has to be an outstanding, right? Even if the promoters are good, but if the business is not outstanding, then there is a very little chance to make money in that particular investments. Let us take an example. Say FMCG is one of the outstanding businesses all of us know. There are various good companies like Nestle, various good companies like Colgate, Dabur, Hindustan Lever. These are part and parcel of an extraordinary company. At the same time, you have another set of a company like say infrastructure businesses, right? So these are sugar businesses. These are cyclical business. At some point in time, they will do extraordinary results. At some point in time, they are into the losses. So if you compare these two, the FMCG is considered to be a much better business, much stable business, and which can give you more extraordinary result for amount of the risk you take. Whereas infra business, sugar business, cyclical business, commodity business are actually do well in particular economic cycle only. Otherwise, you know, they are very risky to hold. And the fundamental investor always look at that particular point in time, that business is extraordinary or not, or is a good business or not, and then he take to the second step. So having ticked the first point, that is the extraordinary business or outstanding business, we will move to the, you know, analyzing the promoter of the company. Now, what do you mean by promoter of the company? So he will look at whether the integrity of the promoter is in check or not. Right now, question is how to check whether the integrity of the promoter is in intact or not. That means for this is a very, very subjective area. And the in order to look at the quality of the promoter, they will study the past various records and annual reports of the company and see what they have promises in the past and whether they have delivered that subsequent, you know, in the coming years or not, right? So that historical study of the director reports, management discussion analysis will give a very good idea about capability of the promoters. Second thing, they will also look at that whether the promoters are involved into any frauds or any another disputes with the government authorities. Now, when you analyze these various forums like vakil.com, annual reports, auditor reports, and you search for these things in your PDF file, you will come to know about various contingent liability, various legal cases going against the promoter. And in such cases, you know, once you go more in deep, you may realize that these promoters are taking shortcuts in order to make profits, and which are very dangerous people to partner with, and they avoid such kind of promoter. Third things they look at about the compensation structure which promoters, you know, has in the company. That means whether what is the median salary, what is the mean salary, you know, promoters are enjoying. Are they unnecessarily, you know, doing certain or getting the high pie of the salaries of the organization? With the managing directors or the whole-time directors who are the promoter of the company, are they are getting maximum share of the salaries, right? Or they unnecessarily do lot of siphoning of the funds, then, you know, they avoid such kind of promoters. Similarly, one also look at into the what are the amount of the pledgings, you know, of the shares done by the promoters, right? Normally the market don't like very high pledge done by the promoter, right? Ideally, you know, zero pledge is what the market love. At the same time, they look at the related party transactions when they analyze the promoters. More and more related party transactions done with the sister concern, associate company, and the profits are siphoned off from the books of the organization to the promoters' books, then this is not the sign of the good promoters. So that is a very, very important thing. So if the promoter is good, that point is tick box, then only they move to the third point, and that is about the valuations. But before going to the valuation, in the previous point about the outstanding company, one thing I want to inform you is about the moat, right? The investor, when they analyze the company, right, they look at economic moat. Now, what do you mean by economic moat? Now, economic moat means the long-term sustainable competitive advantage, right? Whether the company enjoys some competitive advantage, long-term competitive advantage or not. Now that they look for it. So how one can find out? Because numbers always speaks for it. That if the company is continuously earning a very high operating margin, or they have a high market share, high return on capital employed, high return on equity on a consistent basis over a period of time, then it is a very, when it is a sign, it's a testimony to the fact that company is enjoying some good economic moat, some competitive advantage. Then the next question as an investor you have to ask, what is that competitive advantage? Why company is able to earn such a superior performance, right? Why the margins are high? right? So then they look at, they go back to the, you know, various informations available into the public domain, like annual reports, like conference call, investor presentation, or the meeting with the management, and they try to connect the dots, and they will get an insight that these companies enjoying a very high return on equity because, you know, their operating margins are high. Why their operating margins are high, for example, because, you know, they are having a certain, enjoying certain technological advantage. Let's say, for example, pharma company, and they have hit some blockbuster drugs, and there is a patent for them for the next 10 years, then nobody can copy that kind of a process and the products and sell in the market. Then this pharma company might have a superior pricing power and they have a high operating margin. Sometime companies entering into some new products, right, or the some new processes or some technological advantage or some in the new geography, and the growth comes and in which they have an economic advantage over there, which the competitor will take a time to cover, to catch up to that kind of a mode. And the classic example of economic mode is the Gillette. Gillette is one of the classic example of economic mode, because it is said that they are so much advanced in their research that by the time their competitor copy their products, they come out with the new products in the market, right? And then they charge, you know, the superior premium for their products, and their margins are extraordinarily high. So that is a very, very important. Then third thing comes the valuations. Now, what we mean by the valuations? Now, value means what? The value means the worth of the company. And the next logical question comes, how to find out value of any company. Now, please understand, students, the value is a very subjective word, right? And value, as it is said, that beauty lies in the eyes of the beholder, value lies in the eye, in the mind of the investors. That means for a particular company, you know, I as an investor will give a valuation of $X billion. You as an investor might give it is a $Y billion, because my expectations are different and my understanding about the company is different, right? So the valuations is nothing but, you know, is a present value of the future cash flow of the company, right? So when all the future cash flow of the company plus the terminal value in your financial model, when you discount at a particular discount rate, right, and arrive at the present value of that company, it is called an intrinsic value of that particular business or that particular company. So the investor always look at, now here the tricky part is the discount rate. Now this discount rate differs from one investor to another investor. For a person like me or in India who is an investor, you know, the 15% rate of interest may be my expectation, and I would like to discount the future cash flow at a 15%. But maybe there is some foreign investor in their country, like say in Germany or in Japan, the rate of interest are negative, right? So they might be happy to earn 3 to 4% or even 5% in rate of interest, and they might discount the future cash flow at the 5%, and they may arrive at a different valuations. So this is a very, very important when you calculate the fair value, and having worked out the valuations, what the investor does, then investor look at that, you know, is there margin of safety available to me or not. Now the question comes, then what is margin of safety? So let us take an example. Say I have done a valuation of company X based on my assumption and my expectations and my understanding that the value of the entire company is $100 billion, and I will compare that with the market cap of that company and say the market cap is $120 billion. That means it is much more above the value today quoted in the market than my calculation. That means I have to pay extra premium. There is no margin of safety to me, and I will give a pass to that company, or I will wait till the time, you know, the valuation comes in my favor, right? Let us take another example. Say I have valued a company X at $100 billion, and the market value of that company is say $75 billion into the market. Current price is $75 billion. So there is a discount of $25 billion available to me. That means margin of safety is in my favor, and I will try to buy this company and, you know, hold it for the long term, and that will allow me to ride the with the progress of the company, ride the wealth creation journey, and create a wealth for myself. Now that is about the valuations. Then comes, you know, once I decided valuations are in my favor, then the next point steps comes about buying the stocks. Then question comes, right, you know, how much amount of the stock I am supposed to buy? What is the quantity I should buy? So here it is called a portfolio allocations. Here, you know, as an investor, I would like you people to know that before you start your journey in the investments, most important part is divide your entire capital in two parts, the equity allocations and non-equity allocations, right? Based on your risk appetite and based on your expectations and the risk taking ability, right? And based on your age factor and the risk profile. So say, for example, you have 1 crore to invest and your age is say only say 30 years old, then you know you should have 60 to 70% of your capital into equity and 30 to 35% of capital into the non-equity. Now, non-equity means your real estates, fixed deposits, debt, mutual funds, gold, etc., etc. And the equity allocations might be through the direct equity or might be through the mutual fund routes, depending on whether you can do direct equity or you cannot do direct equity, and also whether you have a time available at your disposal to do the research or not. Assuming that you love the investments, you have a time, wherewithal and the passion to do the research, then you may go for a direct equity. Then a question comes that how much stocks you should buy, you know, once you identify a particular company. So here the most important part is allocations. So please understand what I personally do in my journey of investments. In my equity allocation in a one particular stock, I do not invest at any point in time more than 10% of my allocations. So if I have a 1 crore in equity allocations, I will never invest more than 10 lakhs in one particular stocks, right? But the question comes, shall I invest this 10% or 10 lakhs at a one go? The answer is no. You should always start with the small trading positions, right? Maybe initially I feel that valuations are in my favor and based on my assumptions, I feel that it is a good stock to buy. I might buy out of 10 lakhs, I might buy say 2 lakhs or 3 lakhs worth of stocks initially. So I will just give out of this 10 lakhs out, I will give only 20 or 30% allocation initially. Then every quarter I will try to study the performance of the company and check what is the my assumptions, whether the company is performing as per my assumptions. Then if the answer is yes, and I am more comfortable, then even the price is going up, I will start adding and try to do average up. The mistakes people do in the market is to average down. But the key to make profit and create wealth is to average up, because then you know the company well, the company is now doing well, and you slightly even higher prices, you keep adding your allocation till it reaches the 10%. So that is how you do the allocations. And in your career or in a particular year, you know, please understand that even if you hit, you know, 2 or 3 good ideas in a year, it is more than enough, right? Because it is not necessary for all of us to know everything, you know, which is available in the market. It is okay to pass majority of the thing. It is not necessary that we should have a view on each and every stocks which is traded in the market. If we understand few companies, which is our core competencies, the things which we understand, only in those companies we should invest. Hence, you know, my experience of 25 years says that in a year, if I find 1, 2, or even 3 idea, it is more than enough, right? To then just to buy truckload of the companies by doing average up. And that is the most and critical part in the portfolio construction. And also when you try to buy your stock, right, you have to diversify in terms of sectors also. So in your portfolio, so you can find out over a period of time, say in the next 3 to 5 years, you have a 10 to 15 stocks in your portfolio. The most high conviction stock will have a 10% allocation. And the second best might have a 7 to 8%. Third best will have a 5 to 6%. And the last stocks, you know, 10th or 12th stock will have a 1 or 2% allocation. And that is how you will build your portfolio. You will diversify your risk and you have a good fair representation of various sectors in your portfolio. It will have a finance stocks, it will have a NBFC, it will have a consumer stocks, it will have a FMCG, it will have a pharma, then it will have a infra, it will have a banks, etc., and automobiles, etc., etc. So what will happen? You will have enough diversification and only those stocks will come into your portfolio which you yourself understand how the promoters are and how the businesses are performing. So that is a big important part, because I have seen many investors in my career who do first 3 things correctly, but they fail at the area of the allocations, because they don't buy, you know, big chunk of the quantity when they find the good multi-baggers, but they buy hardly 1% or even less than 1% in their portfolio, and they don't make a huge wealth. Now, George Soros has said this thing very beautifully, that in stock market, it is not important that you are right, but it is more important that how big you are right. So when you hit on some jackpot idea, right, you should actually, it's a high conviction idea, you should buy truckload of the stocks by doing the process, as I explained you, by doing the averaging up, right? So that is the most important thing. Then comes the horizon, right? That means it is the investors in fundamental analysis always look at long-term horizon. Now, what do you mean by that? Is this mean that long-term horizon means that I have to forever, I have to hold the stocks? Not necessarily. Because whenever the investor buy any particular stock, his mindset is actually to be a part owner of the company and to remain invested as long as the fundamentals are intact and as long as there is no structural damage into the business of the company. So which are the reasons when he will try to exit the stock when there are some corporate governance issue? Say that promoters are siphoning the funds, or there are certain structural damage in the company. For example, company is into the in the business of, say, restaurants, and some COVID kind of situation comes, and suddenly the people are not going to the restaurants, and this company like Swiggy and the Zomatos are more favorable, and the people visiting the hotel and the restaurant is reducing. There is a structural damage to the business, and he might have a re-look that whether he should continue these particular stocks or not. Even there is an excessive allocation, which is more than 10%, say, because the price is going up in the stock is so much that from 10 to 20 or 25% it becomes part of my portfolio, then he may try to prune certain allocations, book certain profits, bring down the allocations, and keep that money into the cash or into some other compelling opportunity where he can invest. But if he doesn't have a compelling opportunity, he will remain in the cash and he will wait for the right opportunity. Many times the investor also try to exit the stock when they find that there are structural change in the environment, in the ecosystem in which the company is operating. For example, in retail, the brick and mortar retail, like say Future Bazaar or Big Bazaar, and then now we have the Amazon and Jio coming into the place. Now these platform company are riding the mega trend, and they are the future because of the technological advantage they have. And that will put a serious question mark onto the brick and mortar model. Then in that case, he may try to switch over from, you know, brick and mortar retail model to the platform model like InfoAge or Reliance Jio, or maybe in future any other company which is available in the listed space in the retail segment. So that is the only question when he will try to exit. But if the performance of the company is great, it is going very well, and it is an intact and there is no damage, there is no reason to exit, then he will be more than happy to hold the stocks forever. I underline the word forever, right? For example, there is a one famous investor called Nick Slip, right? And now you can look at his letters, which are available into the in his websites and on the internet, where you'll be surprised to know he's a London-based investor in UK. He, for his entire career, he was holding three stocks, right? And these three stocks are Amazon, Berkshire Hathaway, and the Walmart. These are only three stocks he has invested. An entire portfolio of more than $300 million or the pound he has invested into these three companies, and he's continued to enjoy that, right? And when he initially was the hedge fund manager and managing the public money, then the UK regulator forced him that you cannot have so much of concentration with the public money. He refused to do the diversification. He wrote the letter to all the investors that he's refunding entire money to the investor with the request to, you know, buy back these three stocks and continue to hold them, you know, and he himself is doing that. He is retired, still holding these three stocks and actually riding the wealth creation journey. So what I'm trying to tell you, that concentrated portfolio, if properly researched, hold for the long term, and you understand that the company is doing well, structurally there is no damage, cyclicality may come in the business, but the business is not damaged, then he will continue to hold the stocks forever, right? And can create a huge wealth for yourself. That is the part of long term. Now that brings us to the next point, and that is the patience, right? Now the very word holding in the long term definitely require the patience, because if you do not have a patience, you can't hold any stocks for the long term. But there is another angle to the patience in fundamental analysis, and that is what is called is that, you know, for maximum temptation which comes to you, right, for investing into the stock, you will say no. So which are those situations? Number one, say if you look at, you know, CNBC, ET Now, many other social media, there are a lot of talks going around about particular companies doing well, particular companies become double, and but the real investor try to look at those companies, and first question he asks whether he understands those companies or not. If he says, I do not understand this company, I do not understand these businesses, he will give it a pass, right? And that, and even if the stock becomes double, he will not get affected by this. He doesn't affected by the fear of missing out. And that is the most important part of patience. And that is beautifully explained by the Warren Buffett as a core competence. So always stick to your core competence. Always invest in those companies which you understand very well. Second thing that he says, that, you know, he has given a metaphor of Mr. Market, that the market is like a Mr. Market who is a very moody person. Someday he will be very euphoric mode and come to you and offer various companies and various stocks at a very high price. Some other day he will be very depressed and offer the same company at a very discounted price, right? So he's a very moody person. So you should not act every time when he approaches you. When he approaches you means when there is a quote available in the market, right? Sometime Reliance are available at 2,500 and sometime it is available at 800 rupees also. Now, your job is actually to analyze the company, analyze the promoter, keep a tab on the valuations and see that, you know, whether the market is offering you this stock at a discounted value, below the intrinsic value, then only you go and buy the stock. Till such time, remain patient. Do not buy the stock. Simply wait, simply chill with your existing portfolio. You read, keep yourself updated, or do any other thing which you love to do. Follow your passion, but do not allow fear of missing out to creep into your mind and take a wrong decisions. So the name of the game in the fundamental analysis is actually to wait, wait, and wait before you enter the game. And you will enter the game only when odds are in your favor. And that waiting is a quality, that is the virtue, will come only when you develop the patience in you. And after you buy it, right, you should have a patience to hold it till the time, you know, there is something wrong going in the inside the company or within the company or with the business of the company. You should have a patience to hold the stocks. So the real key after the big allocation is actually the patience, because in my journey, of course, I also have my share of mistakes in the past, that if the stocks become double, if the stock become four times, right, then, you know, we always try to encash and try to book the profits. And we realize that we have actually missed a very big opportunity. And I'll just share a very the fair share of my mistakes is a company called Astral Polytechnic, right? Now 5 to 7 years before, when I identified these stocks and I have done all my entire research, including the meeting the management of the company, the after adjusted for the split and bonuses, it was available at 89 rupees. I bought that stock at very good allocations, and the stock actually went up to the, say, the 200 or 250 rupees adjusted for split and bonuses. I thought that 100 rupees stock, 89 rupees stock has gone to 250. You know, it's a multi-bagger for me, and let me book the profit. Isse upar jyada kitna jayega aur kitna growth company karega. And I have failed, and my emotions keep into it, and I have become impatient and I have exited the stock, right? But I keep continuing studying the stock, and I realized that today it is running at even 2,500 rupees. Because I could not control my patience, right? Because there was no structural mistakes in the company. There is no problem with the promoters. Entire things were in favor of the company, both in terms of four cylinder of the growth. There was a sales growth. There was an expansion in the operating margin. There was an operating leverage, and there was a debt reduction. So there are all the four cylinder of the growth are in place, right? But I realized this after making these mistakes, and I understood that the fundamental analysis is not just about doing number crunching. It's not just about doing Excel sheet, but it is more about, you know, understanding yourself, right? As in banking, we say KYC, know your customer. In investment, it is most important is know yourself, KYS, right? You know yourself, you know your emotions, and you have to try to win over your emotions and develop this virtue of the patience. Then maybe in your portfolio, three or four stocks or five stocks, right? And out of that one or two become a multi-bagger, if you can create a mammoth wealth, mammoth wealth. So in the market, nobody is enemy. It is you and your emotions is your enemy. And in order to overcome that, what is you, I have developed my own framework, right? Own process now, right? So that my emotions doesn't come into my journey of, you know, wealth creations. So you as an investor should also create your own framework, your own checklist for entering, holding, adding up, and even exit of the particular stock, and allow that systems and process to work in your favor and not your emotions. And that is a very, very important. And I request all of you, I'll be more than happy to connect with any of you who want to develop these entire systems and process, right? Then we can work on those and can give you a good guidance on those lines also. Then the last comes is the review. The last steps comes is the review. So in the fundamental analysis, right? So people normally believe that once you buy the stock, you are a long-term investor, you just forget. Buy it right and sit tight. Now people misinterpret this word sit tight. Sit tight means what? You just shares liya, demat mein rakh diya aur so jao. Ab kuch karne ka jarurat nahi hai. It will become automatically multi-bagger. No, that is not the case. You have to do a systematically the review of the business of the company, performance of the company, sector in which company is working, and whether the tailwinds are in favor of the company or not. You know, in which stage the company is, you know, company is in a initial stage, company is in an intermediate stage, company in a last phase of the growth, right? That is the life cycle of the any growth you have to understand, continuously how to track, right? And at any stage in this review, you realize that there is a dip in the performance, but the dip is not because of any structural damage to the business, but it is just an economic downturn. Otherwise, you know, there is nothing wrong with the company, nothing wrong with the promoter, then you should not exist. Now that is very, very important. And it is said that whenever you buy the stock, in your diary with the date, you should write 5 reasons why you are buying these stocks, and keep reviewing those 5 reasons at every quarter, half year and annually, right? Whether they are intact or not, whether those assumptions are still valid or not, and whether anything new has come, which has actually added further to your investment thesis, and should you add up more or not? Now that is a very critical part of the review. And that is where, you know, I always say that investment is not the part-time activity. Fundamental analysis is not the part-time activity. It is a full-time job. And in order to do that, either you should have a patience and a time, then only you should indulge into the, you know, investments activity on your own, or else the indirect investment through the mutual fund routes or the PMS route or the model portfolio route is the best route for all of you, right? Now question comes, as I talk about the various tools and techniques are available. So there are some of the tools and techniques, you know, which is available, which free of charge, which you as an investor can start with. The first is the moneycontrol.com, where you will find a lot of information about the company, about the technicals, about the fundamentals, financials, right? There are the forums where people talks about it. Screener.in is one of the fantastic tool available. Same as the Tijori Finance, where you can look at last 10 years data, all the ratios ready-made calculated, your job is to analyze them, all annual reports, credit reports, and also the peer comparisons are available. These are all free of charge. Then there is some good international sites like investing.com is available. Those people who also want to look at the chart, they can look at TradingView and also understand the, you know, what are the technicals about this particular stock and is it the right time to enter into those stocks or not. Right. And as a technical people, you know, those who do technical analysis also know that they also look at, you know, every day in the morning, certain, you know, at what index level the SGS Nifty has opened, at what level international market is open, Dow is open, Nasdaq is open, and they take their view. And for that, they refer to the investing.com and many other international sites. There are many such tools available. And why these tools and systems are necessary? Because these tools and systems, once you put in place, then you have a very structured approach to the investments and you can safeguard yourself against your emotions. So the last punchline is that in the field of the investment, in the journey of the investment, it is you, it is your emotions against which you have to safeguard yourself. Then your journey to the, you know, wealth creation starts and nobody, you become unstoppable to the wealth creation. So with this, I would like to stop end my discussion here and will be more than happy to take any questions which the participant has. Over to you, madam.
Thank you very much, sir, for that very insightful and enriching session. I have a few questions from the student, and we will take a few of them. Sir, one of the first question that I have got is from Rachna. Rachna is asking, sir, today we have realized the importance of patience, and especially as far as fundamental analysis goes. So her question is, sir, can you guide us regarding how to identify a company which will eventually create wealth for us in the long run?
Yeah.
So she was asking in terms of ratio analysis, sir, if you can just.
Yeah. So, you know, the first is stock selection. You have to be, first of all, the voracious reader. My first advice is stop going to the, you know, any social media, stop going to the any, you know, CNBC and ET Now and all these things. Because first you have to cut the noise, right? And focus on the voice. So you really have to look at, analyze the, you know, macro policies of the company. Let me give you one example. Say the government has, after COVID, has announced a policy of the Atmanirbhar Bharat, and under that PLI scheme is the major buzzword today. So they want to attract the manufacturing company, right? Auto ancillary, electric vehicles. They want to mobile manufacturers, and also the, say, lot of automobile manufacturers in the country. So you know that, you know, these are the tailwinds available. Similarly, in the defense sector, there are tailwinds available with the problem with the China and the international geographical movement, which is happening with the neighboring country, and the very, very fine international geographical policies, you know, framed by the Narendra Modi government. You know that in they made a statement to go net exporter in the field of defense. So you know this mega trend. So you know where to look for the next winners. So these are the sectors you look at, and in that sector, just go to the screener.com, find out which are the companies available, start understanding those companies and those sector, read the annual reports, read the various other informations available, connect the dots, right? And, you know, try to do the valuations as all the six steps which I gave you, you will find out. And for the, all the understanding of the ratios, right? Just to give you an example, it is actually a 5-hour session if you want to understand the ratio. But just to give you an example, say you zero in on the defense sector, and within the defense sector, say you come to company X, then you go to the screener, you try to take out all the ratios available on the screener or on the tijori.com. And first thing you look at, you know, to look at what is the long term, you know, the return on capital employed, and what is in the long run the return on capital employed and return on equity. And if this is a fantastic number, right, then ask yourself why the company is doing well. Then start connecting the dots by reading into the equity research reports available in the public domain, or reading the annual reports available in the website of the company, reading the conference call, and reading the CRISIL and the India ratings or many other credit rating reports, so that you can connect the dots and you will understand the sector and the company well. So you will understand why these companies' ratios are good, right? Why then the ratios are again divided in various parts, like what is their working capital ratios, like activity ratios, what is their performance ratios, like return ratios, what is their solvency ratios, right? All those ratios you understand, and while analyzing the ratio, keep asking the question why. Why this company is doing good? Why in particular your company is deep? And try to connect the dots by going to the conference call or annual reports. And suddenly you will see that you have an entire framework in front of you, entire insights available to you, that, you know, and these intense thinking will lead you one step ahead of the rest of the people in the market. So the ratio is a starting point. But after understanding the ratios, you have to ask the why and have to connect the dots. I hope I have answered your query. Over to you, madam. Hello.
Yes, thank you, sir. There is one more question from Manish. And Manish is asking, sir, you had mentioned about top-down approach and bottom-up approach. So which one you will prefer, sir?
Very good question. I personally prefer bottom-up approach. So I prefer bottom-up approach. I look at, you know, certain tailwinds and mega trends, and then I try to look at various companies in that, and those companies start analyzing. I normally do not go top-down approach that, you know, I look at, say, now sugar is in favor, or say infra is in favor, or steel is in favor. No. Many times what happens, I am, while I'm traveling, I am reading a lot of magazines, and I come across many articles, and through that, you know, I get certain insights. Once upon a time, I was reading an article about, say, there are companies who are in the business of manufacturing, you know, the EV batteries, or they want to start by manufacturing EV batteries for electric vehicles. And this is in the auto magazines I was reading. And then that company I started, you know, analyzing, you know, while I come back and start studying that company. So I prefer the bottom-up approach. But both the approach are good. You should stick to whom, which approach you are comfortable with. Over to you, madam.
Thank you, sir. There is one more question from Poonam, and she is asking about market perception of company's management. Does it affect the valuation?
Yes. See, the quality of the management has a strong impact on the valuation of the company, because a good business is must, then a good jockey is also very important. Now, for example, say Eicher Motor, if you look at 10 years before or 15 years before, right? And then after that, when this stage two came in the company and the Mr. Lal took over the company and taken the control in his hand, and then the valuation company put on that management is in front of you. It has become a multi-bagger. Multi means multi-bagger. There are many such other two-wheeler company, but they have not given the same results as what the Eicher Motor has given, right? Similarly, like right now, say you can look at a lot of pipes business, right? So in pipe industry or building material industry, you will see there are certain companies like, say, Astral Polytechnic, where the management is very highly rated. So they have get a lot of valuation in premium as compared to many other small and mid-cap companies in same sectors. They are not getting that kind of evaluations. So the valuation, the management plays very important role, but management is a very dicey game. If the perception goes negative, the market is so ruthless that the same stocks will become, you know, from darling of the company to the, you know, the junk stock. And suddenly the valuation will drop and market will, you know, exit from their stocks. So the if the management falters in their delivery or there are corporate governance issue, then company will go for toss. And you have seen in various IT companies like Vakrangi and all these things, where you've seen how the promoters behave, and from the skyrocket to the, you know, the ground level, you know, the price crash just like anything. It is purely because of the management. So management is a very, very crucial. Over to you, madam.
Thank you, sir. There is one more question from Sanket, and he is saying, sir, can you elaborate about common sense investing?
So these are all the word coined by the, you know, social media. But investing is actually is a common sense. Now, which are those common sense? Is that invest only in those company which you understand. That is the first common sense. Second is buy only when odds are in your favor, right? That means valuations are in your favor when you have margin of safety, right? And do a, you know, position sizing, right? When you understand the company well, you are convinced, your conviction is very high, then do a higher allocation. This is all nothing but common sense, right? That means what? It is very simple to understand. But please remember, things are very simple, but very difficult to practice. Because we as a human being love complications. We love actually complicated things. We love to complex, we add complexity to the things. However, under investments, what is more important is actually to simplify the thing. So it is a common sense, but it is so simple that it becomes difficult for the people to practice. Simplicity is most difficult thing to practice, right? Yes, it is a common sense investing. Over to you, madam.
Sir, there is one more question from Ria, and Ria is asking, what is the importance of cash flow?
So cash flow is very, very important. I'll just put one statement, that sales is vanity. Top line, sale is vanity. Profit is sanity, and cash is a reality. Now, what does that mean? Sale is vanity. The management who only talk about sales, right, is vanity, means ego. It's only talking about ego. Management who understands importance of profitability, that means profit is a sanity, means wisdom, buddhi ka kaam kar rahe, dimag ka kaam kar rahe, right? But eventually cash is the reality. That means your sales growth ultimately should translate into profitability, and your profit growth ultimately should translate into the cash sitting into the company. So now you will ask me, if I am making a profit, I will have a cash? Not necessarily. Because in accounts, as you know, there are two kinds of accounts, a cash system of accounting and accrual system of accounting. Now in accrual system of accounting means, so when I might have sold goods to you on credit, right? And I have made 10% profit on those goods. So the 10% profit will appear in my profit and loss accounts. But I have given you goods on credit and I have not collected from you, and so chances of collecting that money from you is very, very low. Then in my books, there will be only debtors and I have no cash collected in my books. In that case, there is no cash flow in my bank account. So eventually, the cash flow is the key, is the reality. So in your cash flow analysis, you should always look at over a period of 10 years when you analyze the company, what is the net profit after tax cumulatively and what is the cash flow from operations cumulatively, and if that ratio is 80%, that means 80% of my cumulative cash flow from operations I am able to convert from the net profit after tax. That means 80% paisa mera cash mein collect ho raha hai, paisa meri bank mein aa raha hai. That means the company is genuine, management is genuine, business is genuine, and there is a less risk in the company, and then only I should go ahead to invest in that company. If that is less than 80% or less than 50%, it is a very risky. Maybe management is fudging the numbers. Those who are interested can look at the last 5 to 10 years number of 1% beverages. In spite of having a huge turnover, very little cash flow is coming from operations, and eventually you know the fraud of the company came out. So cash flow is ultimate thing which one cannot afford to ignore. Thank you very much. Over to you, madam.
Sir, I think we will take this as a last question, and this question is from Sarika, and according to her, she was asking about this concept of moat. Sir, can you elaborate? You had mentioned that in the in your speech.
See, the concept of moat, it is called economic moat. It is a word coined by the Charlie Munger, and in simple terms, the meaning of economic moat is actually long-term sustainable competitive advantage. That means company is enjoying some competitive advantage, and because of this, company is enjoying high market share and also high return on equity and return on capital employed. Now, how will you come to know that there is some economic moat, some competitive advantage company is enjoying? Say, for example, say I am a Bajaj Auto, and I have done some research in my laboratory, came out with certain kind of a technology and produced some new kind of a bike. And that bike, you know, I have patented and registered with me. And I have introduced this bike into existing market in India also, and also into the international markets, say in Africa, and I'm doing exports. So what will happen, that suddenly this new and superior technology is there, and this is only available to me. And because of this, my competitor cannot fight against me, cannot take away my market share, and then I am protected against the competition. That is called competitive moat. You will find this thing among with FMCG company, you will find this with the pharma company, you will find this with many of the tire company. So what is that advantage? Some people are low cost producer, they have a competitive moat. Say in HDFC Bank, it is their brand is their competitive moat, right? People do not try to switch from one bank to another bank so easily. It is a very painful process. So that is an economic moat, right? So Microsoft is having a window license with him, right? And anybody who want to install, right, the operating system has to approach the Microsoft, and then there is no other competition. It is a virtual monopoly. It's the economic moat. If in the mobile, if the Android has to be loaded, then there is only one system available, that is from Google, and that is the economic moat. So that gives you some superior advantage, and which competitor cannot beat. Right, that is called the economic moat, and every investor look to find out what is that economic moat, and how long it is intact, likely to remain intact, and that will drive a very superior returns from the company, and the valuation of the company will be very high, and you can create wealth in such company. Over to you, madam.
Sir, you have answered many of the questions that we have got so far. It is always a pleasure having you. And sir, I just wanted to ask you, as a, you know, maybe a last word, if you can say something to our young millennials so that you know they have a great journey as far as financial wellness goes. Yeah. Any last words, sir, from your side?
Yeah. Yeah. So all those young millennium, always say rising stars, the leaders in this field, future leaders in this field. If you want to create wealth in the stock market, right? Please develop your own ecosystem, develop your own process, develop your own tool, right? And you have to be a voracious reader, but without your tools and system, right? It is very difficult to create wealth in the stock market, because people read a lot, people listen to a lot of videos, people go to the various libraries and read various magazines and the books, but there are a lot of noise and clutter. The biggest asset in stock market is not money, but it is your clear, uncluttered mind. And that will come when you develop your own systems and your own process. And that will safeguard you against your emotions. And that is the thing in the stock market. And that is my advice, all of you, to develop that for yourself and ride the journey of the wealth creation. Yes, madam.
Sir, thank you very much for this enlightening session. And friends, we will be taking a break now, and we will be joining after a short time for another session on technical analysis. Thank you for joining and happy learning.
Thank you very much, madam, and thanks for the opportunity. Thank you.